people often are shocked when they hear that our members make no payments in connection with their health care. I think that solves one of the problems, I think Dr. Bach identified it, of compliance. That's our goal, is to make sure our members can access their health care without costs being a barrier to them. So wherever there's more than one drug in a class, we always choose the most cost-effective drug, whether it's a generic or one of multiple brands available, as the one that the member will be able to receive for free. Of course, the types of drugs that we're talking about today don't give us much opportunity in that regard, and so the problem becomes ours, how to use the limited dollars available to us that really are diverted from other priorities important to our members, like their salaries or their pensions. How do we use those dollars best to preserve access to all the best medical care out there as we're facing the challenges that are identified today? I just wanted to share in response to Dr. Reinhardt's challenge to insurance companies. We're not an insurance company, but we do buy healthcare for our members, so in that way we act alike. To identify the part of the price increase that, or our cost increase that's attributable to specialty drugs. We happen to have done that for the first half of 2014, where we were walloped with hepatitis C drug spending, because that was just immediately after the introduction of Sovaldi, and also compound drug prescribing. Our overall health trend for the first half of 2014 over the first half of 2013 was 6.1%. Without compounds and hepatitis C medications alone, our trend would have been 2.7%. So our trend was more than doubled. Our overall spending on all healthcare was more than doubled solely by virtue of those two classes of drug spending. So that's our problems. We have an illustrious group of panelists here to talk about the impact of this issue in various arenas and some of the things that they have thought about and have tried to do to mitigate that impact. First, we'll hear from Brian Rank. Dr. Rank is the co-executive medical director of HealthPartners, an integrated provider organization. Next, we will hear from Dr. Paul Sherman, who is the Executive Medical Director of the Health Plan Division, and Medical Director of Care Systems Development for Group Health Cooperative, which is an integrated payer-provider organization. Then we will hear from Matt Salo, who's the Executive Director of the National Association of Medicaid Directors, and you know the kind of problems they have. And then finally, we will hear from Dr. Ruth Lopert, who is currently the Deputy Director of Pharmaceutical Policy and Strategy at the Center for Pharmaceutical Management, but also of interest to us. She has served in the Australian Department of Health as the Director of the Pharmaceutical Policy Task Force and on the Therapeutic Goods Administration. So she'll be offering an international perspective from Australia and elsewhere. So I'm going to turn it over now to Dr. Rank.
Thanks, Mitra. What a great morning. I'd like to thank the organizers. I learned a lot from virtually all the speakers. I would have loved to have taken Dr. Reinhardt's econ class. and maybe econ would have been understandable to me. Memorial Sloan Kettering and Peter are personal heroes. I'm a medical oncologist, and for somebody to take a stand on value in oncology drugs is extremely important. So thanks for the opportunity. I'll provide a few remarks on the importance of prescription drugs and affordability for our patients, members, and our community. Health Partners is based in Minnesota and is the largest not-for-profit, consumer-governed healthcare organization in the country. Health plans serve 1.4 million people, a 1,700 physician care group, and clinics and hospitals that serve about 1 million patients a year. We have a nearly 60-year history of working in our community. Minnesota and the Twin Cities region in particular has some of the best and most affordable health care in the country, and in the Twin Cities in particular have the lowest rates in the country for individual plans in the post-ACA era. We have a triple aim focus. that uses all of our assets, our health plans, our care group, our hospitals, and clinics together in partnership with our patients and members and with employers to create demonstrated high quality, accessible, and affordable care. We are one of the very efficient and high quality pioneer ACOs, and our medical group is accredited as an ACO by NCQA. We are a large and highly ranked provider and health plan for health employers, individual purchasers, state public programs, and CMS. From David Kindig's work, we also understand that healthcare is really only about 20% of the health equation, as Dr. Reinhart pointed out, and that rising healthcare costs are already eating into the other investments in health that our communities and our employers must make to create a viable future, such as investments in education, early childhood development, and livable wages. The value we deliver to our patients and members and our community, however, is threatened by the trend we see in pharmacy costs. The issues with pricing in specialty drugs and even some of the pricing gimmicks for generics have been well discussed by speakers. Our experience mirrors the nation with a couple of examples. Our total cost of care for Hep C treatment was $21.4 million, with 80% of that attributable to prescription drugs and not other care. We expect pharmacy to be about 10% of other care. We've watched the cost of critical drugs that improve outcomes over the past 5 years with nearly double in cost, with Humira, Rebif, and Copaxone being some of those examples, and the indications have broadened. And the launch price of new specialty medications, as Dr. Bach pointed out, in my field of practice has grown exponentially and more complex. Even some generics like tetracycline or colchicine have been around for decades, and the pricing increases in some instances that approach 7,000%. So why is it important? Pretty much daily, docs in our group tell me stories about patients who can't afford their meds or choose instead to go without or to misuse them to try to stretch them with their supply. In my own oncology practice, as Dr. Bach stated, my patients will sometimes need to choose between feeding their family, paying for housing, and a cancer medication that could extend their life. High deductible plans are exceptionally common in our region and the norm in products sold on our exchange. I remember one patient recently in my practice who sheepishly came back to me in clinic after I'd given him her prescription for a medication for his metastatic colorectal cancer. When he learned that the upfront, out-of-pocket cost would have been $1,800 at the window. He was on a fixed income, and he had almost no savings. He would have needed to take a loan out for that medication. We eventually found a different therapeutic strategy for him that was more toxic and perhaps less effective. These are the kinds of decisions we must make in rooms today with our patients, and more of these will occur because of the prices of prescription and specialty drugs. Our organization has many, many affordability initiatives ongoing to serve our members and patients. For pharmaceutical, most of our clinics are at over 90% generics. And that's important. The price of generics is about $21 a prescription, brand $240, and specialty drugs now $4,100. We use all the tools available to us: contracting, specialty pricing, formulary design, benefit design, prior authorization, and making sure our patients understand how to use their prescriptions through work with our clinicians and our pharmacy team members. We provide actionable data to our individual providers that helps them make decisions in the clinic with their patients. And we limit quantities of very expensive drugs we dispense at one time to limit waste in case of intolerance or difficulty with adherence. These are all critical efforts, but they fall far short of assuring affordability for healthcare and needed prescription therapies in the future. The pricing of drugs today threatens to dwarf all of our other efforts to keep care affordable for our patients. I had a number of suggestions on things that we might do, and transparency is one of those, but our speakers are much more erudite than I am in potential options for management of the trend. And so thank you for the ability to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Eng. Okay, our next speaker is Dr. Sherman.
Good afternoon. I was pondering what I could possibly add after all of those speakers, but thought that the unique piece that I could bring is the intersection of care and coverage being a fully integrated system. And all of the things we traditionally have done to try to ensure quality and affordability for our patients, and the sorts of issues these drug pricing schemes are causing us at this point. We continue with all of our traditional means of managing our pharmacy costs and effectiveness, looking through at pipeline and forecasting, drug discounts, prior authorization, preferred drugs, and especially chronic disease management programs. Much of the focus of that really was just quality for years, ensuring the right drug for the patient. And more it's becoming about the cost and affordability, especially as manufacturers, as some of it's been talked about already today, are getting better and better with regulations and advertising at undermining all of our programs, whether it's through rebate programs that take out cost sharing that for patients that contribute to meaningful shared decision making, the fast tracking with single arm trials, phase one trials, non-clinical outcomes, all leading to approval where there's no way to tell if there is truly any difference in patient outcomes. Just this week, Orkambi was approved by an FDA panel, 2% increase in lung function in patients with cystic fibrosis. But no idea whether that improves any meaningful outcomes, but it's for a relatively small population of people, and it will probably be discounted from Kalydeco, so it will probably only be $250,000 to $275,000 a year with no idea whether we're improving outcomes. And one of my favorite, the demand creation with advertising, not only with patients, but with providers. They're starting to do that with hepatitis C. You have this subtype. You can't take the preferred drug, you need to take another one. It harkens back to our very first skirmishes in the preferred drugs with the SSRIs. That all seems so quaint now that we were worried about the pricing back then. But how the drug manufacturers convinced so many of our providers that my drug was better for patients with depression if they have insomnia or anxiety or social phobia. And enlisting our behavioral health doctors to explain to our primary care doctors that they couldn't tell up front which one of those drugs would work better and they should use our first line drug. But then when we turned to the mental health providers, they said, oh yeah, that's true for primary care, but we can tell. And so continuing to work through those issues. Our biggest gem is our pharmacy and therapeutics committee. Which helps us truly understand the costs and benefits, as well as the risks and uncertainties. So many drugs have very marginal benefits and have misleading advertising that leads to the idea of amplification of the benefits and downplaying the risks. And for years, we could just be so proud of our P&T committee that it was only focused on quality, that we were protecting our patients from the drug industry. And in fact, we were, with never putting drugs like Resulin, Vioxx, or Fen-Phen on our formulary because of safety concerns. So we were saving patients' lives. But it's a brave new world now where we actually are coming closer and closer to out-and-out rationing. I think our P&T committee is still best equipped to make these decisions because it's practicing primary care physicians and consumer members who are making the decisions. But we've always made the decisions based on efficacy, but now we're restricting products based on price with limited quality or safety concerns. Obviously, hepatitis C is the prime example. We work closely with the state and with other insurers, and we all have the same criteria in the state about who to treat when. But let's be honest, if the drug was $1 a pill instead of $1,000 a pill, we wouldn't be having these conversations. We're also sacrificing patient convenience. MS interferon products, you can give them every other day for $10,000 to $20,000 a year, or every other week for $40,000 to $60,000 a year. That's no-brainer, but it's still not being truly patient-centered. And then lastly, I just want to mention briefly the new pricing paradigms. I have great respect for Dr. Nichols, but that we are seeing that manufacturers are anticipating that people are going to focus on launch price. So when the MS-DMTs, the disease-modifying therapies, were first introduced. They cost about $10,000 a year. And as more and maybe better drugs, but newer agents have developed over the last 20 years or so, those drugs have gone from $10,000 to $60,000 a year. Not what we've ever seen. Our P&T committee always before would put things on the formulary and then only would look at them again if new safety concerns arose. But when you have a six-fold increase in price, or as Brian said, doxycycline up 8,281% last year, tetracycline up 13,135% last year. We're going to have to start looking at all of the drugs again and doing more cost benefit. And I'll stop just with that little anecdote that it's not just people. That doxycycline now means that what used to cost $70 to treat heartworms in dogs is now $3,000. And so that makes it even more clear that there are lots of family pets that are not going to get treated because a drug for truly unclear reasons has increased in price so much.
Thank you. That's that kind of puts it in a sharp perspective because the cost benefit, I guess, people would weigh that differently. And yeah. Okay, so thank you. And now Matt Salo.
All right, good afternoon. Thanks for having me here. So welcome from the wonderful world of Medicaid, which is the largest, most important program in the country that no one has any idea how it works. So because of that, I will give you a 30-second intro. So Medicaid is the healthcare safety net, and it is big. We cover more than 70 million Americans, and we spent about $450 billion last year. And a lot of that is, you know, sort of below the radar in terms of the average American's experience. And a couple of sort of quick statistics to note. About 5% of the Medicaid population accounts for about 50% of the spending. So you can do the math there. And roughly half of that 5% have a mental health diagnosis. And so Medicaid is, you know, it's not just a program for pregnant women and kids, although it does that and it does a lot of that. It is the program for the sick, the frail, the elderly, and people with disabilities. It is the largest payer of long-term care in the country. It's the largest payer of mental health services in this country. It's the largest payer of HIV/AIDS care in this country, et cetera, et cetera. And I say that because, you know, I want to reassure people, we're used to dealing with people who have complex and expensive conditions. We're used to treating people with traumatic brain injuries whose cost of care is hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. We're used to the patients with cystic fibrosis for whom one drug is $300,000 a year. That's an important backdrop, and it's important to know that we're used to that, and I think that's what makes some of the concern around the current drug pricing so sort of alarming and important to us. But I think it's also important to understand how drugs work in Medicaid. We have something called the Medicaid Drug Rebate Program, which is kind of a quid pro quo. On one hand, Medicaid is guaranteed the quote-unquote best price, something that Tony doesn't particularly like on the private side. I get that. But the hook with that is that Medicaid has to cover every single drug that is approved by the FDA. So we don't do closed formularies. And that greatly inhibits any concept of real kind of market forces in the Medicaid world. And a second piece that I think is also important to note, there's a lot of talk about value-based purchasing. There's a lot of talk about, and even though Dr. Bach talked about some, you know, people leaving oncology drugs at the counter because the out-of-pocket costs have gone up too much, which is, I think, a real concern. Another thing to note, in Medicaid, the effective out-of-pocket cost for consumers and for drugs in particular is zero. So that doesn't work. So we have to figure something else out. And then ultimately, why do we care? You know, Medicaid is 25% of the average state budget. And when costs go up, it squeezes out other things, K through 12 education, infrastructure, higher education, workforce investments, et cetera. This is all very important and it hits home for everybody. So what's new? Like I said, Medicaid's used to dealing with very expensive patients, very expensive drugs, very expensive treatments. The thing that really set this off was, as has been said many, many times, hepatitis C, where, you know, we essentially had the introduction of a drug that utilized orphan drug pricing for an extremely mainstream drug. You know, we're no longer talking about 10,000 kids with cystic fibrosis. We're talking about 3 million Americans with hepatitis C. And, you know, even though it's not realistic to think that all of those patients could get treated in a given year, I acknowledge that. But if you were to do that thought experiment, what would it cost to treat all of the 3 million people with hepatitis C if we were to treat it as a public health threat, the way that many in the public health system, in the VA, the FDA, et cetera, talk about it? At the pricing we saw with Sovaldi, treating hepatitis C at that level would double the pharmacy budget. So that one drug would cost as much as every other drug in the entire Medicaid program. That is unsustainable. That is a problem. But we recognize that, you know, as other folks have talked about, there's a lot more stuff that's coming. So we've done a couple of things. They're in your packet, and I'd certainly recommend you take a look at them. We've laid out some very concrete ideas about what do we do about this. We have a letter that's more specifically targeted to hepatitis C, and you could, you know, just I'll touch on a couple of these. You know, recommendations, yeah, we talked about price controls. We recognize that's very controversial. You got to put it in there. But there's lots of other things you can do. You can talk about risk corridors. You can talk about ways to sort of ensure that we don't have major price spikes. But I think there are also other things that we can do that are pretty thoughtful. You know, Medicaid doesn't really have the ability to effectively use cost effectiveness or comparative effectiveness research to say, yeah, we're just not going to cover that drug the way that so many folks in the private sector perhaps could. And we also don't really have the ability to do innovative things such as, you know, changing the way pricing works. So as opposed to we're going to pay you $1,000 a pill for this treatment, maybe we should just pay you a certain amount if the patient actually gets cured, as a way of thinking very differently about how we do this, because there's no question that medication adherence is an issue, and some of the long-term effects I think we need to think more creatively about. So we have a whole bunch of ideas that Congress could address when thinking about hepatitis C, because I think in many ways it is unique. It is big, and it is a legitimate public health threat. It is an infectious disease. And I would just say, are we going to think about this the same way that we thought about polio or smallpox? You know, what did we do when we found cures or vaccinations to those? Did we throw our hands up and say, well, we'll let the market figure it out? No, we didn't. We had a much more thoughtful, national, coordinated strategy. I would argue we need one here. But I do also think that we're going to be facing similar issues for a lot of other conditions. And that's where I think we need to be thoughtful as Congress is considering things like the 21st century cures. We're all for cures, we're all for innovation, but I think we need to be very careful when talking about this in the Medicaid context, because if you're talking about lengthening exclusivity, that's the thing that keeps prices as high as possible for Medicaid. You know, for hepatitis C, you know, it was $1,000 a pill, and we got some rebates, but the minute there was a competitor in the market, we were seeing 40% price reductions. What we need is more competition, not less. And I think the final thing that I'll mention is that in Medicaid, because it's a captive market, it's not a free market, it's a captive market, and it is a very complex market. It is the oldest, the sickest, the frailest, the most people with the most complex conditions, these are not the people who are undergoing clinical trials. So when we say we're going to expedite trials to get drugs to market, that's fine, but I think we need to be very careful about doing that in the context of the Medicaid program, where I think you actually probably need more thoughtful looks at safety and efficacy. So I'll stop there and happy to answer any questions later. Thank you.
Thanks very much. This is the least fun part of this job, is having these speakers who have so much to say, so much insight, getting them to stop talking because we have limited time. But we have all agreed that we'd like to give Dr. Lopert, a little bit of extra time, since she brings perspective outside of the constraints of the system here in the United States that so many people have referred to. Dr. Lopert. Thank you.
So I'm going to start off by throwing a spanner in the works and saying, can we please stop calling these specialty drugs? There's nothing special about them except they cost a lot. And as the price goes up, we're going to see more and more drugs fall into the rubric of specialty drugs. So I have a problem with that to begin with. The other thing I would argue is that, is a drug any less special when the patent expires and it's subject to generic competition and gets cheaper? So I just find the language a little bit odd in that sense. At the rate the price of doxycycline's going, it will be a specialty drug pretty soon. And seriously? Okay, so anyway, I'm like Len Nichols, I think we should be a bit grateful to Gilead, because the decision to charge $84,000 for a course of Sovaldi has really brought this issue into a spotlight that it was sort of, we skirted around a lot before, and I think it's really good that we're having this conversation now. Some of the ideas that we've heard today, I have to say, are very familiar to me, and I'm going to talk a little about what we do in Australia. Nobody really cares about Australia. It's this tiny little country, at least in terms of population, on the other side of the world, and we all know that American problems need American solutions. And I've been working in the US on and off since the around about 2006, and nobody really wants to hear about Australia, so I'm grateful for the opportunity for being invited here today to talk about it. So I'd also agree with Len that the arguments at higher and higher levels of IP protection, such as those that the US are pursuing in the TPP that Tony mentioned, and higher and higher prices and therefore return on investment and necessary incentives to innovate, is just, I would argue, it's not borne out by the evidence anyway. Anyway, just to talk a little about Australia, because that's really what I've been asked here to talk about. Just to give you a bit of context, a lot of people refer to Australia as one of those countries with socialised medicine, which always makes me laugh, because our current Prime Minister is ideologically more akin to the Tea Party than anyone who could reasonably be described as a socialist. But we have had universal drug coverage for almost 70 years. 70 years. And we had universal drug coverage 30 years before we had universal health insurance, which is kind of back to front when you think about it. And we're probably the only country in the world that has installed a single-payer system and then ripped it out and then put it back again, all within 10 years. So we tried it without, and then we put it back. And I think that says something about Australia. So since the late 80s and early 90s, we've operated something called a fourth hurdle system. A fourth hurdle system is referred to as a fourth hurdle with reference to the first three hurdles, which are safety, quality and efficacy, which are the criteria that you need to meet in order to get a product registered and on the market. The fourth hurdle is the hurdle of cost effectiveness, which is a prerequisite for listing on our drug formulary. We have a closed formulary and we're not afraid to say no. We do not regulate prices. There are no price controls in Australia, but there is indirect moderation of price through the application of cost effectiveness as a criterion for formulary listing. So how does it all work? It's an essentially comparative assessment. We've been using comparative effectiveness research for 2.5 decades as well. We require clinical trials showing the benefits of a drug against the therapy most likely to be replaced in practice, which will usually be the standard of care, and may or may not be a drug therapy. For example, when we looked at bosentan for primary pulmonary hypertension, the standard of care was lung transplant, so that was the comparator. And we look at, the comparative effectiveness and the comparative cost effectiveness when we look at a drug where there is no clear difference in clinical benefit. The legislation actually states that the drug cannot be listed on the formulary at a price higher than the comparator, unless for some patients at least it provides a meaningful increment in clinical benefit. So we use reference pricing. If two drugs offer the same clinical benefit on average across the population, then we don't limit the number of drugs on the formulary, but they can't have a higher price. If a drug provides an incremental clinical benefit, then it can be put on the formulary, but we make a judgment about whether the incremental costs associated with acquiring that incremental benefit are justified. And yes, we do use the dreaded quali, and no, it isn't perfect, but it's the best thing that we have at the moment. We do not have a fixed threshold because the cost effectiveness criterion, the comparative cost effectiveness criterion, is not the only game in town. We also take into account whether there are reasonable alternative therapies, what the cost to the individual is, what the cost to the health system is, and whether there are alternatives and what the clinical need is. So there are a whole lot of issues that get taken into account. The cost effectiveness, as I said, there's no fixed threshold, there's a sort of vague threshold of around $50,000 Australian per quality adjusted life year. But there have been drugs that have been added to the formulary with cost effectiveness ratios much higher than that, and drugs which have been rejected at cost effectiveness ratios that are lower than that because of the uncertainty surrounding that calculus. And uncertainty weighs heavily on our decision making. The point is, though, that unless you have the willingness to say no, you can't seriously moderate the price. You have to be prepared to walk away from the bargaining table. And essentially, that's what Peter Bark talked about. Peter Bark said, we will not use Zaltrap at Memorial Sloan Kettering because we have an alternative which is equally effective at half the price. What happened? The price dropped by half. And I think there's a really object lesson there, and I've cited that example many times. I could talk about the pharmaceutical benefit scheme in Australia for several hours. I've been known to talk for 5 or 6 hours without actually pausing for breath. But I won't. I will say one thing, though. We think about it. It's value-based payment. What we think about is that we are purchasing an outcome, not a drug. And if we can buy the same outcome for a lower price or the same price, why would we pay more? You wouldn't do it if you were buying a TV. You wouldn't do it if you were buying a can of baked beans. Why would you do it for a drug? It doesn't make sense. So a couple more points that I would like to say. There were mentions by some of the other speakers about we have to be able to rely on competition. I think relying on competition is great, but you can't. Sometimes there won't be effective comparisons that you can make. Sometimes there won't be effective competitor products. But not only that, anyone who says we can rely on competition to lower prices should look back at Nexium and Prilosec. Because if ever there were two products that were very, very, very similar, if not the same, it's those two, and it did nothing to modify the price of Nexium. The other thing is that... I've lost my train of thought. I will end with one more point. Do I?
Yeah.
Okay. No, I think I would just like to leave as much time as possible for questions and discussion. I would reiterate the point. There was a comment made about withholding clinically appropriate therapies. I would argue it's not about withholding clinically appropriate therapies. It's about prioritising them and being prepared to walk away if the cost... the cost effectiveness is not demonstrated. So many times we see the benefits of new drugs immoderately hyped in the media, and when you look at the evidence, it doesn't stack up, and the incremental benefits can be very, very modest and the price is very, very high, as we saw in the examples given today. The final point I would like to make is that I know it's very unpopular to talk about a program or a protocol or a policy where you actually say no. But I actually think that the most erudite description was at the end of a paper by Deborah Schrag in the New England Journal in 2004, when she was talking then about the increasing costs of oncology therapy. And her final comment was this, and I would just finish on this point. As a society, we are reluctant to systematically deny access to expensive treatments that extend life by only a few weeks. but the morality of refusing to make deliberated choices is itself questionable. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much. Join me in thanking the panel. And as Dr. Lopert said, we have reserved some time for questions and discussion. And Bill has a question right there. On your right, Bill, there's a microphone.
Thanks. Mr. Salo.
Yes.
My position on Medicaid rebates is that the last time state Medicaid programs enjoyed a real discount was the day after the law was enacted in 1990. Since that time, every new drug introduction has had the price, you know, of the discount baked into it. Mm-hmm. So 25 years later, what purpose does the minimum Medicaid rebate really serve in getting the program down to where it should be paying for drugs? Wouldn't you be better off having the freedom to say no, as we've heard today from many of the speakers, than having this 23.1% crutch now that you're guaranteed that minimum rebate, but you can't negotiate because you have to include every drug in your formulary? Now, you do have preferred drug lists, we understand that, and I think that if you would expand on the use of preferred drug lists and get rid of the Medicaid rebate, that the Medicaid program would save even more money than it does right now with its guaranteed minimum discount. It also would free the rest of the market to be able to negotiate more aggressively, because I have been handcuffed for the last 25 years in my negotiations with pharma based on Medicaid best price, which Tony, this morning in his opening presentation, really pointed out very nicely.
So I think it's a great question. It's a provocative one. I think the short answer to that is I think it's worth taking a look at it again. I'm not sure that it is still working as effectively as it was intended to, or if in fact it ever actually did. I think what we would need to be careful about is, you know, Medicaid is 56 different state programs. Would some of them end up losing out if you were to just wholesale dismantle the program? I don't know that the answer is yes. The answer might be yes, so I think we need to be careful about that. You know, when you're talking about 56 separate sort of political entities, which in themselves are an executive branch and a legislative branch, et cetera, you know, some of those states in a new environment might be even more handcuffed than they were in the past. But it's worth talking about. But right. And many, many states are currently in one or more cooperatives to do this. I would also react, and I was thinking about this when Tony said this too, and I know that many, many people in the private sector who have to compete feel frustrated that, you know, that the guaranteed rebates, the best price that Medicaid gets, sets this floor, artificial floor that they can't go below. I get that. But let me turn that around and say, but do we really want, as a 30,000 foot public policy goal, do we want Medicaid as a beleaguered, underfunded, constrained healthcare safety net without which there would be literally people dying in the streets everywhere? Do we want Medicaid to be paying a lot more for things than the private sector? I don't know that the answer to that is yes. So I would just be careful about some of that. I mean, Medicaid pays, and a lot of people don't like Medicaid because it pays a lot less than the private sector for a lot of things. It is the safety net. So it's just, I'd just be mindful of that.
No, I'm submitting that Medicaid would actually be able to do better if it would free itself of the shackles of the Medicaid best price discount and negotiate in a cooperative, in a government cooperative. I think you'd be able to drive better prices, and it would free the rest of the marketplace to negotiate accordingly. I think on some of the slides that we saw, Medicaid represents 9.6% of drug spend. That's a pretty nice hunk. If you all joined into a cooperative those 56 entities joined a cooperative, you would do a lot better, I believe, negotiating without having to have every manufacturer's drugs on your formulary. I see no reason why Medicaid beneficiaries have to have access to every drug in the universe. Why do they have to have access where managed care beneficiaries don't? My own drug plan that I have, I don't have access to everything. You know, Mitra's group doesn't have access to everything, but there's a quid pro quo. You play by the rules, you get your drugs for free for $11.99.
Yeah, I think it's a great point. And obviously we want to have access to the right drugs, to the appropriate drugs. Again, because it's a very sick, very frail, very fragile population. But, you know, the universe of FDA-approved drugs are not just those. I mean, I remember when Viagra came out, Medicaid had to cover that because of the drug rebate program. Now, we actually went to Congress to get a law passed to say that, no, you don't have to expend Medicaid funds to do that. But is that what you want? I hear you. Worth talking about.
Any other questions? Yes.
There's a lot of talk about the new drugs coming out and the prices that they are getting for them. But I don't hear much about old generic drugs that have been around forever that maybe are only made by two manufacturers, slowly going to one manufacturer, with the price going from 49 cents a vial up to $85 a vial in the case of neostigmine, or in the price of other drugs, we're talking $1,200 an amp. Nitroprusside is $605 for an amp of nitroprusside to make a drip. Cost you $1,200 now. Is anybody looking at that? And what can we do about it?
Well, I mean, you referenced that. I think this is a huge issue. And I think you're exactly right in that what's driving it is consolidation in the market. There are far fewer generic drug manufacturers because at some point they all said, well, we're not making enough profit on this, so we're going to stop making it. So the market consolidates and then they can charge whatever they want. And, you know, I can tell you one thing that might fix that on the Medicaid side. I don't know what that does for the rest of payers. But again, in the Medicaid specific world, one of the provisions of the drug rebate program is, you know, states get additional rebates if the cost of brand name drugs go up faster than, I think it's CPI. We actually get dollar for dollar. So that helps tamper down some of that crazy cost inflation. That provision does not exist in the generic space. And I would argue that it should.
And in defense of the pharmaceutical industry, it's not all consolidation. Some of it's regulation. Some of it is enforcement that we have seen action against manufacturers for not having state of the art or sufficient facilities. And so coming up to the current requirements cost money. There's been some raw material shortages, and that's probably the last time you'll hear me defending.
Well, it's also some of the laws that colchicine is a drug that was actually found in the mummies at a time for gout. And because we'd actually never tested it, a company taking it and doing a clinical trial was then able to price it. And so the question of why a 9,000% increase in the cost of colchicine is allowable when it's been around and tested and useful for years and because of those particular regulations. I think, though, that generics are kind of the when you turn about, you know, if Gilead is dropping the frog into the already boiling water, which is what it is, the generics are kind of the slowly turning up the heat and boiling the frog. And it's because, you know, generics are 89% of our drugs and only 9% of our costs. And so, whereas the, quote, specialty drugs are less than 1% of our costs and are about 21% of the cost. And so that's the one, and I think we have to pay attention to both and to have rational pricing strategies for both. But the big kahuna here is the price of the new specialty drugs. And the other thing that I, in oncology drugs, my colleagues bring to me a 9-page single-spaced potential new drugs, and each one of those will have a pricing strategy that maximizes the income. And so I think that this is really scary.
Indeed. Bill, did you want to?
Yeah, just to add to your answer, doctor, on the culture scene example and to this gentleman's question, that is as a result of the FDA's initiative on unapproved drugs, which started back in 2008 or 2009. There are currently 2,900 unapproved drugs that the FDA is encouraging manufacturers to do the new drug application work on to submit to them for approval. So once somebody takes the initiative to do that, right, in that case it was colchicine, we have isoproterenol, we had vasopressin, nitroprusside, they will then get de facto exclusivity on that drug because FDA will then exercise its regulatory discretion and send out cease and desist notices to any of the manufacturer who had been making that old unapproved drug forever. And we saw this about 6 years ago with the emergency syringes, right? Dextrose, atropine, you know, epinephrine, all these drugs been around since, you know, Moses, but the FDA wanted them to be NDA approved. So the two manufacturers who made those drugs, one of them, Amphastar, said it wasn't worth their while to file NDAs for those emergency syringes. So they pulled out of the market and left it all to Hospira. And that put Hospira into a tailspin. And the FDA came back and said, whoa, we jumped the gun here. Never mind. And then Amphastar came back to the market. But they are still pursuing this initiative. And savvy manufacturers are combing the lists of unapproved drugs and picking out those molecules, running, getting raw material exclusives over in Asia on the raw material for these drugs, and then coming to market and raising them 2 and 3,000%. And these are the type of questions I get from my hospital members all the time. You know, why did this drug just go up by this ridiculous amount of money? So it's a big issue in generics, and unfortunately, the FDA's quality initiative is driving some of this.
Thank you, Bill. We have time for one more question.
Thank you. So I kind of sense a disconnect between the value proposition a drug has versus the price of a drug. And it seems, I think this is kind of illustrated by potentially this conference in the sense that it was really motivated by both Sovaldi and Harvoni, which are highly priced, $86,000 respectively. Yet, and for the health plans, they're very concerned about the budget impact of the drug. So in Tony's presentation, it's the $5.1 billion that it may cost. Yet they're, for health economists, we're very concerned about our value proposition in the sense that how much dollars per quality or how much dollars per life year a drug has to save. And there doesn't seem to be as much of a overlap in the discussion as one would expect. You know, so I'm wondering what, as health plans, health payers, what could motivate more of a discussion about the value proposition of a drug and inclusion of that when discussing prices, because just saying a drug costs $50,000 isn't necessarily, I think, a fair judgment. You know, does that $50,000 save 2 years, 3 years, et cetera? So, thank you.
Do you wanna address that?
Can I comment on that? Because assessing the value proposition, as you've described, is very much what we do in Australia. But I would make the point that even a drug that's highly cost-effective can be unaffordable if the scale of treatment is very large, which I think, and Sovaldi is probably a good example of this. But I actually also think that the value proposition, as good as it probably is, has not been proven in Sovaldi either. I mean, we hear people describing Sovaldi as a cure. But it's not. It's a surrogate endpoint we're measuring as the effect of treatment. It's the viral load. We don't know. We don't have any long-term data. Now, I'm reasonably confident the long-term data are going to be pretty good, but we actually don't know. And I think to call severity a cure is actually overstating the case a bit. At this point in time, we know that some of these patients will relapse. That's absolutely the case. And you're measuring a viral load in blood, and you do not know how much virus is still in their livers, frankly. But be that as it may, the point is that I think it's really important to not to focus on the cost, but to focus on the comparative cost effectiveness. What are the options? And we know that the other options in hepatitis C are miserable for patients. And to be able to take an oral drug once a day and to have a really good outcome is a fabulous step forward. But, and you know, it will obviously save a lot of downstream costs, but it's not cost saving in net terms, no.
Brian, or Paul, did either you want to address that?
So I guess I ought to apologize because I thought that I was communicating how we looked at value, as I thought several other speakers were. I think Ruth's points are great. It is as how we lay out our guidelines for who to treat currently with hepatitis C, because in fact, they say it's a cure. Well, it's a cure for a disease that most people will never get sick from. So that's the other problem is it clearly is high value to treat people who are sick or have indications that they are going to become sick from hepatitis C. But if you take a general population, and I haven't looked at the numbers recently, so maybe someone can correct me, but it's like you're treating 20 people to make what we guess is a clinically significant outcome difference in one. So it's not $100,000 per person, it's really $2 million to have one clinically significant difference in outcome. Well, what's the quality around that? I mean, those are the discussions that our Pharmacy and Therapeutics Committee routinely has.
Yeah, and just from the peer payer perspective, as I said at the beginning, we always enable our members to get the treatment that they need for free, and where there's more than one option, we choose the most cost-effective one. We are stuck with the bill where there isn't the ability to choose between them. So I think it's implicit that we think there is a value, a tremendous value, for our members to be able to access healthcare of all kinds, including drugs that may not have competitors or any ability for us to drive the price down. If there is no other drug, that is the one that the member will get for free, because we recognize the value to them in terms of the clinical outcomes. But that doesn't mean that we can just spend their money without trying to do something about keeping those costs in check so that that money lasts, so that that money can cover all of them and all of their health needs, not just all be directed to the cure of the one out of the 20 people who receives the, or close to cure or whatever, who's receiving the Sovaldi.
To our panel. Thank you, moderator. Could have given each of you a full session. I really appreciate you all coming, particularly those of you from the West Coast and from Minnesota. Thank you very much. I wanted to say one other quick thing before everybody leaves. All of this information, the videos of today, will be on the PQC USA website. You can get all the materials. The slides will all be available. We'll be sending out materials to those of you who were registered.